And apparently we are online.
Yep.
Should I ask my wife if we are streaming or?
I think I see the tag, the flag live.
Not yet. The cabina di regia, not yet. Some seconds to go online, and then we are ready. And there is the bell tower here that is saying that I'm close to a bell tower and saying that it's 5 p.m., so we are ready. And then we are online, and then we are online. We are online because I'm already receiving messages from friends that says that we are online. So good evening to all the people listening to us. It's a pleasure to have all of you here. I see that the number of participants is already 85, but it is skyrocketing. We expect to have more than 100, maybe 150 tonight. Tonight, we have very special guests. You already maybe see their faces, but let me first introduce my co-chair or co-host, depending on the vocabulary. If you use the scientific vocabulary, Anna, it is a co-chair. So Anna Gregorio, associate professor in astrophysics at the University of Trieste. She is also an entrepreneur because she is also a spin-offer. And maybe she will explain us the little satellites that she produced, and also a person that has a very rich past of space missions, but from the ground. And something, Anna, that we discovered just some minutes ago is that you worked also with Margherita Hack, correct?
Yes, right.
That's really amazing. And then directly from DC, we have Ivona Cetinic, oceanographer in the Ocean Ecology Laboratory at the University Space Research Association, NASA Goddard Space Flight Center. Was it correct, Ivona?
Yes, it was great. It's a long thing, but it's my pleasure to be with you here tonight.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for being with us, Ivona. And then last but not least, of course, we have the honor to have with us Umberto Guidoni, astrophysicist, science writer, and also former ESA astronaut. So being the first European to visit the International Space Station. Good evening to Umberto Guidoni.
Good evening, everybody.
Thank you for being with us. Thank you also to the control room at the University of Padova, Raffaella and Faustin, that will be our, let's say, Houston Center in case something goes wrong tonight. Thank you for your help. And now, Anna, it's time for the rules of the game. So what are the rules of the game of tonight?
Okay, so first, this bureaucracy, let me say. So let me remind you that all your microphones are muted and you cannot use your webcams. But remember that the chat is active. I would expect it will be very, very active. So we wait for your question. Today we will for sure have fun. And well, thank you, Guido. Thank you all for that opportunity. I think will be a great day.
Yeah, even because, Anna, we have a specific we reserved some minutes for the question and answer. So in the very last part of our webinar, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, fantastic. So I think that we can start. So the first guest is yours, Anna. Please.
Okay,
go.
So finally, back to our exceptional guest, an astronaut and rocket scientist. And I bet now many of us, still children, would have dreamed of becoming an astronaut and admiring our magnificent blue planet from space. So me for sure, and I'm still dreaming. So let's then start with talking with Umberto Guidoni. So yeah. Umberto,
yeah, I saw the movie just started. So if you can stop there. You can stop the the video, because otherwise we lose everything. Thank you for inviting me to this webinar, and it's a good opportunity to talk about what can be seen from space. Of course, I am not an expert of oceans, but I can talk what I can see, what we astronauts can see from space. And in order to give the audience an idea, I brought this video with me. That is just a way to show, because I think video is much better than words in this case, especially when you have to see what really the Earth looks like from space. So we can start here. We already missed the first part, but we are here on the elevator that goes to the catwalk, the astronaut used to go to the space shuttle. And of course, you see, I had the call just now. You see the 6 seconds before liftoff, the three main engines are turned on and the shuttle is on its way to space. Endeavour begins to rise slowly. It's a 20-story building going straight up. In few minutes, it gets supersonics, and then it exceeds 28,000 kilometers per hour. Using the space shuttle, we build an amazing outpost in space. We are back in 2001 when I docked with the International Space Station. In the Endeavour cargo bay was the Italian module Raffaello to be attached to the station. The day after, here we are inside Raffaello to transfer supplies into the station. In addition to clothes, water, food, there were scientific experiments. The box that you are seeing, I am carrying, is housing a protein crystal growth experiment. You see, astronauts can float. We are in a weightlessness environment. And this is a strange new condition where high and low has no meaning whatsoever. So in space, you really have to learn again how to live in such a new environment. In space, you cannot cook. You must use canned or dehydrated food, sealed in plastic bag to make them edible again. You have to add water. We don't throw food normally to each other like you see here. But this image show you what it means living in weightlessness. Today, the International Space Station is the largest structure ever built in space, the size of a football field. It goes around the Earth in 90 minutes, and it is a perfect platform to look down at the Earth. And this is a beautiful view of Italy, but to look with the naked eye, the lack of human presence is striking. You cannot see cities or buildings. Other amazing views of the Mediterranean Sea, the coast of Egypt, and the delta of the Nile. And as you see, even there, you cannot see the city of Cairo. After 45 minutes, the day is over. And then you can admire a beautiful sunset in orbit. Look at the sun. It's bright and white, and the sky is black even in sunlight. When the sun disappears, a pale blue halo is visible around the planet. It's our blue sky. It's the Earth atmosphere. At night, of course, you can definitely see lights illuminating the landscape. Here comes Italy, and you see shining city lights, street and coastline. Now you can see a beautiful color of the northern lights. It's really like looking at fireworks extending for hundreds of kilometers. After 45 minutes, it's all over again. A new day starts, and you can see the Caribbean Sea and the Haiti Island. It's a really beautiful view from space. Then what we are looking now is not Mars, but we are flying over the Namib Desert at dawn. Now back to the station, and this is the wonder of the station. It's called Cupola, and it's a perfect spot for Earth observation. It's the astronaut best place to take astonishing picture of our planet. Here we see a hurricane on the Atlantic Sea, on the Atlantic Ocean, and also from there you can see the wounds caused by humankind, like wildfires in California or deforestation in Brazil. You can see lighter patches where trees were cut. Now to the main topics of today, the sea from space. Here we are on the so-called Scattered Island, and with a great view of the reef. From space, we can observe coral bleaching. Under stress, the coral turns white. In these two pictures, taken 1 year apart, you can see the reef getting wider. A beautiful image of the Elba Island in the moon glint, and phytoplankton blooms in the summer, spanning hundreds of kilometers across the Baltic Sea. Now we leave the Earth to look at other worlds that might have water. Today,
this is a topic, Umberto.
Okay, we can stop
actually
here.
For the next, let's stop here. Let's not anticipate too much, but. Umberto, I'm thrilled but also shocked, because apparently you just proved that the Earth is not flat, actually.
It's not flat.
Not flat. So, you know, there are communities of people that think that the Earth
is
flat.
I know very well, because I had the, well, I say I was lucky enough to meet some of them. And so I know.
What, and you convince them. You convince them.
No. It's not possible. It's not possible. It's
not
impossible job. I mean, it's impossible task, because they have their own physics. They have their own law of nature. So there is no way we can find a common ground.
But tell me, according to them, you are simply lying. What?
Yeah, that's what they thought. They think that astronauts are liars. I mean, they don't know.
Okay.
They say what the NASA wants them to say, but there is no way. I mean, even pictures like the one I showed to you, for them, is just an artifact.
CGI.
Yeah.
My God. Umberto, thank you so much for this fantastic introduction. You know, it was really fascinating. But now it's time to go to Ivona. My first question, Ivona, icebreaker question is the following. When you see astronauts like Umberto, what is your first sensation reaction? Is it, wow, I would like to be there? Or is it, oh my God, these guys, they are all so crazy, better to stay with the feet on the ground and stay safe? What do you think?
So the reason why I'm doing what I'm doing is because I wanted to be an astronaut. But as we all know, Croatian Space Agency is not so big in launching things. So, I never became one. And I'm like really thankful to people like Umberto, and I'm definitely in a group of like, wow. Like, you know, every time, like when you were showing these images, like still, and I see them all the time, you know, like the hair on my arm stands up, because it's such an unbelievable view of our planet, of our home, you know? And it's thanks to people like you that we understand, you know, like the beauty, the fragility, and how blue it is, how awesomely blue it is.
It's
really the water world. And yeah, and like, I'm with you there. I had my own polite interactions with people, the flat earthers and stuff, but yeah. I want to be Umberto when I grow up. That's
okay. Listen, Ivona, in reality, my question is a serious one. Umberto, in the last part of the video, showed us some images, for example, of deforestation and the coral reef and so on and so forth. So my first question is about the visible changes occurred, no, to the seas and to the oceans when seen or observed as you do from satellites. What do scientific data tell us? And here I'm asking to Anna, if Anna, she can broadcast the video that Ivona gave us, because you suggested
we have had a small problem in the sense that you have to allow me to share with
Houston.
So while Houston is dealing with that, we can talk.
I can finally say that. Say Houston, I've done it. No, what I can do is to launch the video. Maybe Faustine.
No. I can do it now.
That's amazing. You know. The cabina di regia from Padova reacted in a few seconds. That's really amazing. So, what does this video tell us or help us to understand, and your job in general, of course?
Yeah, so I'm an oceanographer at NASA. That's sometimes weird to hear because everybody thinks like, you know, the only thing NASA does is, you know, shoot people in space like Umberto. But, you know, in order for us to develop instruments to study space, we have to kind of look back towards the Earth. And that's what you're seeing here. It's not a CGI, as all those flat earthers would say, but it's actually information data that NASA and using some of the collaboration with European Space Agency, it's the information they have been collecting over the last 20 years continuously. And these changes in colors that you see are actually showing you the presence or absence of on land plants. So like, you know, so look at the North America now. So it's like, when, you know, springtime, summer, ice went back, ice comes down, that's your winter. And that's easy, you know? So it's like, you know, how, you know, leaves are forming, leaves going away. So now when it comes to the ocean, it goes a little bit different. So what we're seeing is something that Roberto mentioned before is actually phytoplankton. These are teeny tiny plant-like organisms in the ocean that are green, similar like spinach or plants or whatever. And their presence in the ocean is changing color. And we can see that from space. You know, like, you know, I mean, I'm from Croatia, so I'm going to push Croatia as Umberto was pushing Italy. You know why Italians always come on Croatian side of Adriatic? Because their sea is clear, but we don't have too much phytoplankton or sediment. But when you go in front of the Venice or like, you know, just like that upper portion of Adriatic Sea, the water looks murky, not because it's dirty, but because it has lots of sediment and lots of algae. And that's what we can see from space. We can see this difference between, you know, Croatian side that is prettier and Italian side that is more productive, you know? So those changes in number of things in the ocean, number of these little plants in the ocean are indicated here by the changes of the color. So you go, we're now crossing Pacific, no? And you go this purple to blue, to yellow, to red towards the coasts, no? And this telling you like no phytoplankton, lots of phytoplankton. And what we have been doing is observing this from space for the last 20 years. And thankfully, having 20-year period observation, we can start seeing the changes that are really, really abrupt. So when it starts spinning back and comes to the Atlantic Ocean, and at the bottom of Atlantic Ocean here in the southern Atlantic Ocean, you're going to see this little purple patch. And then the similar purple patch is going to start appearing in the South Pacific Ocean. And this is a place we always look first because these are some so-called deserts of the ocean, where there's not too much phytoplankton. That's always that way. But what we've been seeing over the last 20 years is that these deserts are becoming larger. No? The amount of phytoplankton in there is becoming larger. So what do we care now? It's like, you know, everybody cares about plants. Well, who eats phytoplankton? Phytoplankton, little plants are eaten by little animals. Little animals are eaten by fish, and fish gets in your plate or doesn't get in your plate. So what does plants do? They produce oxygen that you breathe. They draw down carbon dioxide. And as we're going through these things, you know, there's these changes and abrupt changes in ecosystem, in global ecosystem. They're modifying our food availability. And the air that we breathe, as well as lack of control of the climate. So this is like one of the things that we observed, just like one really bad things. So like when it comes to the temperature of the ocean, we have observed over the last 30 years or even 40 years that we've been looking at the temperature of the ocean, this consistent change in temperature of the ocean. Sea level rise, the same thing. Just in, I think in 15 days or so, European Space Agency and NASA are going to be launching a satellite called Sentinel-6 Mike Freilich, which is going to be focusing exactly on a sea level rise. So it's a joint operation that's going to be continuing, I think, 45-year-long mission on observing the sea level rise. So pretty much if it wasn't for this global satellite data observing ocean, we wouldn't be able to understand how bad it is. But it's also important to understand that we can use this data to model what's going to happen tomorrow and in a way build resiliency for the coastal communities, for the economy, and hopefully, you know, for the climate itself. So,
and do data confirm, Ivona, that this trend is exponential? And do you think that it can be still stopped, or it is too late to stop it?
I mean, depends what you're looking. It's really not an exponential, but there's a definite line that we can fit in it. No, so here you can see Arctic sea ice in a minimum area. You can fit a nice linear relationship there. And there's wiggles around, and every year you can say, oh, look, everything is okay this year. Well, it's not. You know, you have to look at the whole trend that is going down. Can we stop it? You know, I'm not a climber, predictor, modeler. It will take a lot of each of us to start changing our behavior, to start changing the way that our nations behave, to start changing, to actually make an impact. But I have a small hope. And one other thing, technology is developing really rapidly, you know, like clean technology, clean energy technology that is helping that. But it will take a lot. It takes right now a lot from all of us to start changing our ways.
Thank you a lot, Ivona. And Anna, your turn.
Yes, now back on myself and again with Umberto. So let's discuss about again about water, but in our planet, for example. So will be the solution for us not in the next future, but recent press releases have talked about the discovery of icy water on Mars, for example. Not even to talk about moon, for example. But yeah. What does this mean for aerospace research? Can we really start dreaming about the real possibility to live on another planet in the future, let me say?
Yeah. Well, as you know, a lake a few meters deep has been discovered by a team of Italian scientists using data from Mars Advanced Radar, an instrument on board the Mars Express, a European probe that is orbiting the red planet since 2003. It is the first known reservoir of liquid water on present-day Mars. Scientists believe this water may be millions or even billions years old. The remnants of a larger body of water now lost from the surface of Mars. Potentially, this discovery offers fresh clues about how Mars transformed from a warmer, wetter world to what is today a dry, freeze planet. It is also a keystone in the search for past or even present life on the red planet. But there is a big but. The water we are talking about is liquid, is very salty, but it's 1.5 kilometer underneath the ice. So for the time being, we cannot drill 1.5 kilometer with the current robotic technology.
So we have to clean our planet.
Well, one day, a crew admission to the Martian poles may sample the surface, and maybe they can get more clues about past or present life on Mars. This is really an open question, but it's one of the most important reasons why we want to go to Mars, no? To discover if there is life or not. On the other hand, this discovery is very important because if we ever want to colonize Mars, then we have really to think about the resources. And a key element is how much we will be able to use Mars natural resources. It's all about working smart and more efficiently with the resources available on Mars. The more in-situ element we can use, the fewer supplies we need to send to the red planet. And I want to give you just an idea how much the estimated cost, how much does it cost to bring something from Earth to Mars? It's about $50,000 per kilogram. So you understand why it is important if we could find easily available water on Mars. That would be much much easier for us to really plan to establish a settlement on Mars.
And sorry to intervene, but I want to remind to all the people listening from home to use the chat to make questions, okay? So use the chat because sooner or later we will end our questions for our guests. And so it will be your turn because we are not enough intelligent to make a question for a couple of hours. So we need a couple of hours, just 50 minutes.
A couple of hours is a long time.
Come on, Guido. We can figure out a question.
I can do it.
And Umberto and I can start asking, no?
Yeah, of course. Umberto, thank you so much. We have seen fantastic pictures, Ivona, and you said before that you wanted to become an astronaut, and maybe you still dream. So have you booked your trip for Virgin Galactic already or not?
Not yet. I'm planning to do that tomorrow.
Really?
I was thinking about doing that today, but you know what? I had to prepare for this, so I didn't book it, but I will book it tomorrow.
But you would do that. You would do that.
Oh, unquestionably so.
You know what? When I think everybody watched the landing of the Demo 2 mission, on the first one with the crew on board, what really struck me was when they finally the flight was over. They had the astronaut on board the ship, and they said, "Thank you for flying with SpaceX." So that for me was the really something. I mean, it was like going on a trip on an airplane.
But of course, wow. Ivona, jokes apart, how was space missions in general changing because of the entrance of private vectors like SpaceX by Elon Musk? Do you think that this will create a total reshape in the industry?
I think so. I'll just I'll go back and 10 years, it was 8 years ago when we were just discussing the mission that I'm currently working on. One of the biggest concerns that we didn't have launch vehicles anymore. There's not enough launch vehicles for the missions that are kind of focusing on Earth because, at least from perspective of NASA and stuff. And then, it's not just SpaceX, many of these private industries that are showing up now today, not only they're offering launch vehicles, but by reusing the launch portions of the launch vehicles, that's what we call rockets to shoot things in space. Allow everybody to do it. I mean, if you can build a CubeSat, it's going to cost you around, I think $100,000 or $140,000 to launch that CubeSat, which is for a project of size that I'm working on, that our budget is $840 million. That's nothing, no? So $150,000 is any kind of university, anybody can launch a CubeSat. And that just not only helps things move, but opens up that portion of the budget to push it back towards the science and develop of the technology. So you're actually accelerating everything because you're refocusing your portion of the budget into development of new instruments, better launch vehicles, better tools. I think it's going to reshape everything and ultimately, hopefully, allow us that step into the, to the moon and then to the Mars and then further Mars, whatever you want to go first. But I think from my perspective, it's a paradigm shifter, big paradigm shifter.
I agree as well. But I would like also to ask Umberto, if you don't mind, the same question. Mm-hmm. If, Elon Musk and friends will change forever, let's say, the industry, and how?
Well, I think that we already, as I mentioned before, we already see the effect, the fact that NASA astronauts actually are going to fly on private vehicle. This is something, it was almost impossible, actually.
Look at the private vehicle here, yeah. It's already going to Mars.
That's the one that I'm going to be flying out.
It's already flying.
I want my own private one. It's going to be purple.
Yeah. Okay.
But I mean, that was impossible 10 years ago when the shuttle was still flying. So it is really shifting of paradigm. And I think we will see more and more of that in the future years. Of course, NASA is talking about going back to the moon, but some of the hardware that will take us back to our satellite will be built by private companies, and this is really amazing. On the other hand, this open up really the number of people that could fly in the future. In the first 50 years of space exploration, a little more than 500 people traveled to space. I believe in the next 50, years, will be millions. And that's just because we will have private companies building spacecraft that could bring people into space. We could build infrastructure, new station around the Earth and probably around the Moon, and even based on the lunar surface. This would be the first step. And then from there, we will see. Of course, Elon Musk is talking to go to Mars in few years. I don't think it's going to happen, at least not in few years. It will go, it will happen eventually, but it will take decades to take foot on to get to Mars.
Well, it's interesting because you mentioned the need of some infrastructures also for preparing, you know, the industry to this scenario that is fascinating. And I imagine also, you know, galactic traffic lights allowing people to go or stop and stay in line. Instead of to stay in line in Mestre, you will stay in line, you know, close to the Moon, hoping that the network of Autoreel won't be built by the Benetton family, because it's really awful. So hoping that someone else will win, you know, the tender for the network of space galactic Autogrill.
Well, we already have traffic problem in orbit, especially now with
right.
The new
plastic and aluminum.
With the new launches, the SpaceX is launching 50-100 satellites with one flight. So it's going to be worse for sure.
But Elon Musk is also betting with European companies to compete with him. So it's really becoming an aggressive competition. Anyway, worldwide. Anyway, let me prepare the last question for Umberto. Once upon a time, kids were dreaming to become astronauts, like I think all of us here talking with you. Today we dream of becoming influencer or something like that. So for us, it's impressive. But indeed, on the other side, seems that something like 60% of the kids will perform some activity, some jobs that does not yet exist. So it's difficult to foresee what will become the future of our space mission and of people working in this field. What do you think about that? So is the future already written in the star, or still completely unknown?
Well, you know, I, as I mentioned, I expect in the next 50 years to see people leaving Earth to go into space, maybe into orbit or on the lunar surfaces or on Mars, just to do their work, just as it happens today with the remote region on Earth. So the next generation will go to work in orbit, and that's for sure. And we will have engineers, pilots, even farmers and the tourists that will live in space for weeks or maybe months. On one end, we will become space will become an extension of our planet, and we will be connected, we just mentioned before, with the future orbital installation or with the lunar and Martian bases using satellite internet or interplanetary 5G network. It seems science fiction, but NASA just signed an agreement to put a 5G network on the Moon. So it's not so far away. On the other end, space technology, such advanced sensors, renewable energy sources, or water recycling system can help us to solve our problem here on Earth. But you mentioned the stars. This is really something that is very far away. I mean, I think we are going there eventually, but it is a long shot from now. Anyway, I believe we are going to reach Mars. So the question is not whether or not we will reach Mars. We will reach Mars eventually. It's only a matter of time. And talking about the next project, you know, the next world where we will just come go back is the moon, the Artemis program, which involves building the space launch system, a rocket more powerful than the mighty Saturn V. I mean, the people of my age remember Saturn V that reached the moon in the 60s. And we are developing also the Orion capsule, that is the modern version of the command module, the Apollo command module. And this is to fly to the moon and beyond. So the idea is that the moon will be the starting point to develop, to explore the solar system. And Mars, of course, is the next closest world that we can reach. And I mean, it seems too far away, but I guess it will be a question of a couple of decades to reach Mars. For the star, it's a completely different question. I mean, it would take tens of millennia just to reach our neighboring star, Proxima Centauri, four light years away from the Earth. So I think it's something that we cannot achieve with our present technology. However, I guess you heard about this breakthrough Starshot program. So they think that a nanocraft, more or less the size of a stamp, attached to a large light sail, could be propelled by ground-based laser beamers and reach 20% of light speed. So in this way, it could make the interstellar journey to Proxima in 20 years and beam back home images of recently discovered planet, Proxima B, that according to what we know about, it could have condition, supporting life. I mean, we don't know much to tell the truth, but it's in the what is called the green zone, the zone that is good for life. So the star is too far away, but the history of humanity is a story of great leaps out of Africa, across ocean, to the sky, and into space. So it's a human nature to go where no one has gone before, to say with the words of Star Trek.
That's really fascinating, Umberto. And actually, I invite you, Umberto, to open the chat and to give a look, because we have so many questions, and maybe you can pick up three for the next round, that is the final round when we will talk, and we are very close. Because I found a question by Ali, for example, that in my opinion is close to poetry. That is, he was asking, is our future linked to the discovery of space? Wow, that's really a fantastic question. Congratulations, because it's really an amazing question. My last question, Ivona, for you, actually it is the same. But before, I want to ask you that some days ago, NASA confirmed the discovery of water also in the moon. The question is it still water or sparkling water? So what?
Okay. So just for everybody, for disclosure, Guido asked me that question so I can prepare. And I did. I went back and read the paper, and I have concluded it must be sparkling because it's containing little balls of glass. So if it's in glass, then it's sparkling. So
it could be
sparkling water, Guido.
if it contains glass, right?
Yeah. And that's the thing. You can NASA. You can cite NASA to say that it's sparkling.
Okay.
So this is a proper scientific result.
Exactly. It took me exactly 5.5 seconds to come to it.
Good.
My question was more serious, Ivona. That was also for you. What is your perspective on the future of space missions? Because also the space missions influence your work and your future research. What is your perspective on that?
So future space missions, I mean, like Umberto said it all. Ali's question is our future linked closer to exploration of space? I think yes, because, you know, not so many people know, but like side products of all these different things that we built to fly to space actually helped a lot with the human medicine and lots of other things. And as we work towards going towards the space, we're trying to optimize the technology and optimize, you know, make it more robust, make it more durable. And all that stuff informs the technology that we're using on Earth day to day. I think our future is there. But one important thing is that it's not the wish only that is, you know, enough. You know, as you said it itself, we have a bit of a problem, but influence is being much more sexier thing to be than being an engineer scientist. I agree with you. And that's a big problem, because in order for us to get to the star, somebody has to build all the spaceships and somebody has to build that infrastructure. We have to have people. And I think my opinion is this, that like, I think each of us on a scientific side have to devote, or engineering side or whatever, a substantial portion of our portfolio to do exactly what Umberto and I are doing right now. Talk to the other colleagues, talk to the general public, talk to the people who are actually financing our work, because all our work, all the space exploration is financed from your tax dollars. So, and not only that, when there's a question here, is like, you know, and it's coming from Croatia, how did I end up in NASA coming from Croatia? For a little girl who wants to be an astronaut in Croatia, if she's now 6 and she talks to me, do you think she's going to have a problem to do everything in her life to become a NASA scientist? No. And that's an important thing. We have to push women. We have to push scientists. We have to be out there and talking to the teeny tiny creatures in kindergarten and try to grow them and inspire them from the beginning. That sky is the limit, and not even sky. I mean, Roberto showed that sky is not the limit. We have no limit. So I think, you know, investing our time and the scientific portfolio, you know, of our scientific portfolio, not to sit in our stupid, like academic, like, you know, whatever they call it, ivory tower, but go down and talk to the people and explain them what we're doing. And I think if more of us do that, we wouldn't have problems with flat earthers. We wouldn't have problems with all these issues that we have currently today, where people do not trust science, but we would actually be able to inspire them. They would be working with us and hopefully becoming one of us in future to build these spaceships to take us to the stars. So hopefully that
people don't trust science. People don't trust science. My God, you are right, Ivona. Yeah. You are really right. And that's really bad, you know.
But I think that's our responsibility. I think it's the scientist's responsibility. Partially. But I think it's the scientist's responsibility. No, but it is. It is.
No.
Go back to your undergrad professors. And tell them, you know, okay, I'm going to be doing a thing here now with the project in Amare. You should be better writing your paper. You should be thinking about your career. No, don't do that. Come on. And that's the problem. They was sitting in scientific institutions for 30, 40 years, and we have literally lost. We have lost almost one generation.
No, I totally agree with you. I was talking with young students a few days ago at the university. Totally true. You have to make them passionate about exactly. Science.
Exactly.
Yes. I totally agree.
Well, I don't know if Umberto, you had the chance to look at the questions, because that I wouldn't know which one to pick. Maybe you choose.
Well, I think I will choose one that asks how much. How much these space programs cost? Because this is something that come up very often. Of course, the numbers in itself is big. Like for example, to build the International Space Station, the cost is more or less of the order of 200 billions. Mm. But we are talking of something that span over 20 years. I mean, just the next November. The 2nd of November, we will reach 20 years of permanent presence, human presence on the space station. So in 20 years, we spend that much. But the benefits for Earth are you cannot even mention, because it's not only a question of science, research, technology development. I think one thing that is really priceless is the fact that for the first time we have in space something that has been built by humanity, I would say, from every country, even Russia and the United States, that were confronting them during the space race. Now they are working together. It's not lasting for long, I'm afraid. But at least we had this great collaboration. And in addition to USA and Russia, we had 10 European countries. We have Japan, we have Canada. So it's really an international endeavor. And I think this is one important thing about space. To succeed in such a difficult environment, we have to put together the best technology that the humanity can put in place. So this is really what the space is all about. So 200 million, billions may seem a big chunk of money, but in reality, if you compare with other expenses and military expenses, it's just a fractional part of the budget of a country.
We have to join forces to win these challenges. I think this is really a great message. Thank you, Umberto. Ivona, did you have the opportunity to find some interesting, intriguing questions that you want to answer?
Yes, there's a couple of questions. How do we see things from space? And I can just kind of answer a couple of them really fast. So I think I explained really badly earlier that the way that we see things in the ocean is because, you know, like think about your glass of water and add something red in it, well, the water is going to become red. And in a sense, that's how it works. So if you add things in the ocean, or they are in the ocean, so phytoplankton is green, same as your spinach, your sediment is kind of like grayish, brownish, yellowish, that's going to change the way that we see the ocean. And the way Umberto saw it from my International Space Station, that's what the satellite is doing. It's actually seeing that. So then kind of going back to the detailed question, great garbage patch, oil spill, phytoplankton. So let's do the great garbage patch. Sadly, we don't have any specific techniques that we can see the plastic from space. We're not there yet. I know some of my colleagues have worked extensively on that and trying to use infrared region of the light spectra to kind of try to detect certain things, but we're still not there. Problem is, I mean, it's just like, just not there. And current, even if we can do that through infrared, which is not kind of still proven, we don't have instrument in space. And the way the development of the instruments in space works, that we usually on Earth figure out, oh, this is how we can measure. And then it takes 5 to 7 years for us to build a new mission, usually to do something like that. But as I said, with the CubeSats and cheap launching services, maybe some students can come up with the idea how to see that plastic from space and launch their own little CubeSat, and then goes on to the oil spill and phytoplankton. So phytoplankton, there's different types. Most of them have green colored them. All of them have green colored them because they're like teeny tiny spinach, no? Or peas or whatever you want to call them. But sometimes they have other colors like roses or different types of flowers. And by combining the knowledge of what kind of other flowers they have, we can distinguish like good phytoplankton that feeds the ecosystem, bad phytoplankton that blooms and messes up the, you know, the tourist season in Trieste or stuff like that. So we just pretty much use the color of the ocean to distinguish these different types. And then ultimately oil spills. You can actually use satellites to see oil spills. There's different types of approaches. You can use the color. You can actually use, this is pretty cool approach. So when the satellite is looking down, the sun is usually behind its back, no? Mm-hmm. And when you're looking at yourself in a mirror and sun is behind your back, what you see is reflection, no? It kind of glints at you, no? So what we do, we kind of tilt the satellite a little bit so it doesn't glint at us. But there's portions where we're moving from one side of the tilt to the other side, and that glint to like screeches directly in your eyes, in the eyes of the satellite. And if you have an oil spill, it's going to be visible in that glint coming from the ocean. So even like the yucky portion of the data that we really don't want, we figure out that we can start using it to check the oil spills on the surface of the ocean. So it's just like a bunch of different tricks that people have figured out.
That's really interesting. That's really interesting. Ivona, Umberto, thank you for being with us. It's a fun.
Thank you.
50, we are more, you know, more on time than taxes, you know. Incredible, incredible. That's really incredible. I just want to take advantage to this moment to remind to all people, you know, that are here tonight that tomorrow we will be navigating the oceans with Margherita Pelaschiera and Giovanni Soldini. So stay with us tomorrow evening at 5 p.m. in Nova Mare Projects. And Anna, I already thanked our guests. The floor
Thank
is
you.
Yours for a final statement.
No. I mean, just enjoy the space. I think everybody really shall do whatever they like. And I think the future is the space. So the space, but enjoy the
future
scene.
Is in the space. The future is in the space. Thank you all. Thank you again, Umberto Guido.
Thank you all of us.
Ivona Cetinic.
Thank you, Umberto.
Goodbye to all of you. Goodbye and see you tomorrow at 5, navigating in the oceans. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Ciao.
Bye. Ciao. Thank you, Guido.
Bye.
Ciao.